Thank you. to talk in between each of the suites. So the suite that I just played, I believe is in your program, is the second Bach suite in the key of D minor. The pieces become increasingly more complex as they go along. I'll talk about that in a moment. Right now what I want to talk to you about is the cello and sort of where it came from. The form of the cello is about 450 or so years old. It didn't really quite have a standardized size and dimension until about the mid-1600s. The cello is a descendant of, it's actually a hybrid of two different instruments from the violin family. So we have the soprano violin and then the alto violin, which is a viola today. There was a tenor violin and a bass violin. And the tenor violin and the bass violin couldn't quite find their niche within the world of classical music in around 1600 or so. So what makers started to do is they fused it. They made the tenor violin a little larger and the bass violin a lot smaller. And so then we have the cello. When most of you go to an orchestra, you see a violin section, a viola section, a cello section, and then a bass section. The bass instrument that you see in an orchestra actually does not come from the violin family. It comes from the viol family, V-I-O-L. And the viol had a slightly more triangular top to it and a flatter back, which is why it sort of has that very low, growly sound, because there's not as much room in the air chamber. And with the plates flatter, they don't quite vibrate the same way. So again, the viol family sort of became around 1400, late 1300s. And there was also the lute family, of course, which is a smaller instrument, kind of pear-shaped. Strings for all of these instruments back then were not made of metal. They were made of catgut, essentially. And strings back then tended to slip out of tune more easily just due to the shape that the fact that the catgut is elastic and the climate changes and humidity changes would allow them to stretch. So around 1660, people started experimenting with steel round strings, and it stabilized the intonation of the cello. The main makers of musical instruments were Andrea Amati, Gasparo da Salo, and Antonio Stradivarius, which this cello is one of Antonio Stradivarius' cello, which dates from 1696. Thank you.
Thank you.
So the first piece that I played was in D minor, so the opening movement starts like this, which is a D minor triad. After the prelude, there are five more dance movements. And the dance movements in the time of the 12, 13, 1400s, and even as far as the 1500s, were really more to be danced at. So for example, the orchestra of lutes or of viols or even violins would play the dance movements and they would be less ornate than what you're hearing now, and people would be in elaborate costume and dance to these dances. Again, in the middle to latter part of the 1600s, composers such as Vivaldi, Corelli, Gemignani, who are very famous Italian composers, started composing solo instrumental music, so no longer was the violin or the viola or the tenor violin going to be an accompanist, it was now going to be a soloist. And so the other Italian composers were sort of about half a generation before Bach. And when Bach came to start composing, in probably around 1695 at the age of 10, he had about 30 or 40 years worth of music that had already been composed that he could start to listen to and base his compositional styles on. Bach was one of the most prolific composers, and he had five professional positions in the course of his lifetime. The first two were religious or liturgical positions where he was hired to compose church music, and many of the cantatas come from the first two periods. The third period of his life, he was hired by Prince Leopold, who absolutely loved music. So it was during those 6 years from 1717 to 1723 that most of the instrumental music as we know it today was composed. I would like to know if you guys know who the Brandenburg Concertos are and the Well-Tempered Clavier. Those were all written during those 6 year period. As I mentioned earlier, the suites themselves were written between July and December of 1720 when Bach returned back to his post at the Principality of Köthen, and he composed the suites, and he also composed the sonatas and partitas for solo violin. The suites have sort of they were well played during Bach's lifetime, but shortly thereafter they sort of became non-existent. And it took a couple hundred years for them to sort of resurge into musical society. A cellist by the name of Pablo Casals started performing these works in public in the early 1900s. When the Bach suites were composed, they were not only supposed to be solo pieces, but they were also supposed to be pedagogical pieces for the aspiring musician. Pedagogical in the sense of melodic line, pedagogical in the sense of harmonic structure, the way voices will stack on top of each other, and also mechanical and technical pedagogical tools. And it was Casals who highlighted the beautiful melodic motion that goes through these pieces in within the chaos of notes that one plays, that there's beautiful melodies. And so he took this and he put a very romantic interpretation to it, which was highly successful in bringing these pieces and works of music to the forefront of the cello literature. And during the last 40 years, purists and musicologists have decided to go back to some of the original bowings and fingerings, which is what I do, as opposed to adding lots of vibrato like we would hear in romantic music. Vibrato was not a tonal color or an ornament used during Bach's time or the time that these pieces were written. So, again, as I said, there are six movements of the suite, the prelude, and then five dance movements. And they have various origins, whether it be Italy, Germany, or France. The last suite that I'm going to play is this suite number 6 in D major. It wasn't written for a 4-string cello, it was actually written for a 5-string cello called a violoncello piccolo. So the 4 strings that you see here would have another one to your right, which would be an E string. So instead, today we of course only have 4 strings, so the cellist goes higher up.
Okay, just drop my water there.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. has an encore for us, so if you'll be seated again. Let me say again that it's been a tremendous honor to have you here tonight, to have this concert in the memory of a wonderful young lady, Ashley, and to have Ashley's parents with us, Jim and Rose Selena. It's been a tremendous honor to have you. And John, an honor to have you.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here. I hope it's appropriate, but I would like to publicly thank one person, and that's Elaine Mattson, who sort of has become my new best friend. Elaine had discovered me in Washington, D.C., and she was sort of a voice out of nowhere, sent me an email asking me to borrow a cello, and I really didn't know quite what to make of this, because we all get a little spam in our mailbox sometimes. In any case, she followed it up with a phone call. I think the next day or the day, or I emailed you back right away, and we started talking on the phone, and she sort of did her Google search to see who I was, and I'm a cello teacher and a cellist, and I live in Washington, D.C., and I had mentioned to Elaine, because she had invited me to her concert that she was doing with David Ott's orchestra, and I said, you know, I would love to do it, but I'm actually playing my own concert that day, and I was playing the Schumann Cello Concerto with the Landon Symphonette, which is a local performing arts orchestra. And in any case, I never thought in my life that I would see this woman who was a voice from out of nowhere come to my concert. And lucky for me, she did. And not only did she bring me here, she just has been the most generous, kind person that one could possibly befriend. And so I'm really blessed to have her become a part of my life. And I would like to play one of my favorite movements of the suites, which is actually the prelude to the first Bach cello suite, and dedicated to you.